Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome again to Glenwood Online, the last day of January.
Oh, yes. That's nice, isn't it?
It is. We're heading to February.
Yes, yes. The nights are getting lighter.
The nights are getting lighter. Mm. And you said the lights are getting lighter. Whatever you were about to say there. Yeah, I know. So how are you, Rachel?
I'm okay. I'm a little bit zoomed out.
You are, aren't you? How many Zooms?
By the end of the week, I'll have done about 12 Zooms.
12 Zooms.
And I think I've realised that is my limit, probably over my limit.
I think you're over the limit. Dave and I have noticed that.
Yeah. So I've been a little bit spaced out, actually.
Yeah, you have. Still are.
Yeah, I still am. So forgive me if I make even less sense than normal.
Yes. Yeah. Well, we'll let you know when you do. I believe, I'm sorry about this, folks, that you've got a joke.
I do. And it's very timely, actually, because we've had a skip delivered outside.
Why are you pointing over there? It's over there.
Oh, it's over there. I told you. Skip delivered over there. For the scout hut.
For the hut and some stuff in phase one. We're binning. Yeah.
And that sort of reminded me that Roger sent me a message this
Roger
week.
Roger who?
Roger Harrison.
Well done.
He sent me a message saying that he'd had a skip delivered.
They had a lovely Facebook photograph, didn't they?
Lovely Facebook photo. And he said, he sent me this, with lockdown and the multitude of movement restrictions, we thought we might get some reshaping work done on the garden, which I think a lot of people are doing.
Can I make a suggestion?
Yeah.
You say that a bit slower.
Oh. Really?
Yeah.
For you, is it?
For me. You've got to think of my age.
Okay. A bit slower. With lockdown and the multitude of movement restrictions, we thought we might get some reshaping work done on the garden. So I asked the council if it would be allowed to have a skip on the pavement. They replied, yes, of course, the exercise will do you good.
That's terrible, isn't it?
It's good, isn't it?
That's terrible. I wouldn't mind a bit of reshaping on my body, but I must be honest with you.
Maybe you should skip.
I should skip as well, yes. Well,
and also, it was Roger's birthday. Last Sunday. He was 85.
85, Roger. You look so good for 85.
Amazing.
I've got to be honest. Yeah, but we're not going to sing happy birthday because Rachel and I have been hurt, haven't we?
We have been hurt. Our confidence has been shattered.
It has, by the comments that have been said about our attempts at singing.
Yeah.
But people have even said it's not singing.
Well, I know. So
I'm not mentioning any names, Andy West, but there we go. Anyway, happy birthday.
Yeah.
Now, a number of people commented how much they like those videos we showed last week. Funny videos.
Yeah.
My brother sent me another one.
That already makes me worry.
It makes you nervous. Yeah, last time I said my idiot brother, and Dave, being pastoral and sensitive, edited that out.
Oh.
So I just spoke to my brother this morning and said, I'd call you an idiot. He said, well, I am. And I said, you say far worse things than me, don't you? He said, yes, so it's my idiot brother.
It is, and no editing this time.
No editing, Dave, this time. So here it is. Have a look at this. You watch it, we'll show it twice because it really is funny, and the punchline you got to get.
Three of the hardest things for people to say: I was wrong, I need help, and Worcestershire sauce. Three of the hardest things for people to say: I was wrong, I need help, and Worcestershire sauce.
That was fantastic, wasn't it? Can you say that?
Very good. Anyway, more serious things.
So today, a little bit later, we're going to be having a prayer and a time of remembrance for the many, many lives that have been lost through COVID. And obviously, it's been a sobering week this week with that sort of figure being reached. So we do want to spend some time just reflecting and remembering those in mourning at this time. So we did send out a message saying have a candle ready, because we thought it'd be nice to light a candle at home together. So if you haven't got that, maybe pause your video now and go and get a candle. Okay.
Wonderful. So coming up now, we got a reading from Linda Camilleri.
Lily.
I said Linda, didn't I?
You did.
Lily Camilleri. Sorry, Lily. Then we're going to have a song, and then we're going to hear from Tim Lockett.
Excellent.
you must have the same attitude that Jesus Christ had. Though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges. He took the humble position of a slave and was born as a human being. When he appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience to God and died a criminal's death on a cross. Therefore, God elevated him to the place of highest honor and gave him the name above all other names, that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow, in heaven and on earth and under earth, and every tongue declare that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
Oceans are all your greatness. Hello, I'm Tim Lockett. I have a wife called Keris, and I've got two daughters called Aira and Fionn, and they're 11 and 9 years old. I've been coming to Glenwood for about 15 years now. I've been involved with quite a few projects over the years. The first one was called First Fruits, where we had a house for pregnant women who were had been in some sort of crisis. Then probably my favourite was the Lovely Jubbly Holiday Club. Being part of the mega event team was brilliant. Throwing water balloons at kids and stuff, what's not to like? I've been involved, made quite a few friends actually on some bike rides, long distance bike rides for Speakeasy. And then I spent a bit of time serving on a Sunday evening at Tavs, but that was cut short by COVID, haven't done that for a while. Most recently, I'm part of the youth teaching team, so I do the Sunday mornings, and you might have seen me, here in front of that camera, doing the Sunday morning youth tube over the last summer. So a fun and interesting fact about me, which is like the worst question I've ever been asked really. I did a trail marathon in the summer. It was a marathon, but it was over the hills of the Brecon Beacons. It's a bit of a midlife crisis, if I'm honest, but it was a lot cheaper than a motorbike. But I did raise a bit of money for Speakeasy as well. So what people or books have shaped my faith journey? Well, if you know me, you know I don't really do books that much. I'm not always that keen on people, if I'm honest. But I guess when, not long after I first started at Glenwood, I did an Alpha course, and that was with the Gorringe family, Andy and Jeanette, but also facilitating was Rachel Tressider and Roger Harrison. That's skydiving, ballroom dancing, COVID beating Roger, who is an all-round hero, everyone agrees. So I guess, yeah, they shaped my early faith journey. And I should say Paul as well, shouldn't I? Yeah, Paul Francis. if you could give yourself one piece of advice when you became a Christian, what would it be? I'm going to say patience and faith. Now, I know that's two pieces of advice, but it's my interview, isn't it? It might not seem that things are always going your way or that God is doing the things that you think he should be doing, but have patience and have faith, because whatever he is doing, it'll come together at the right time and it'll be way better than you'd imagined it to be.
Well, thanks, Tim. That's great. And it's great to hear from you. He's so gifted. He's such a gift to the youth work, isn't
Absolutely
he?
Absolutely brilliant gift. Very good at fixing bikes.
He's very good at fixing bikes. Anything you want to know about bikes, he's your man. Tim Lockett, the
man.
Bike.
And anything, actually. He can fix anything.
He can fix anything.
It's like Bob the Builder.
Bob the Builder. And he made a thermonuclear missile out of washing up bottles. Quite remarkable, really. But anyway, just for those who don't get our emails or Facebook, and if you want those, let us know. About 10 days ago, we heard from Joseph Frank Foundation that they wonderfully given us £35,000 grant.
Amazing.
Which is wonderful, which means we're £32,000 still short. And please keep praying for the Lang Foundation. They still haven't replied to us. And we're going to need a few more, 10 or 20,000 to help refurbish it. But in terms of the build cost, it's 32,000, which is remarkable, really.
Wonderful.
It is
wonderful.
Remarkable. Well, of course, Rachel, as you mentioned earlier, this has been quite a sobering week where the cases rose above 100,000 people who've died in the UK from COVID.
Yeah, and that's the UK alone.
That's just the UK. Yeah. I think it's over 2 million around the world. It's just a horrible figure. Jane was telling me during the First World War, the Battle of the Somme, on the first day, 60,000 British troops died on one day.
Gosh, Yeah,
it's just sobering, really, actually. And the Archbishop of Canterbury this week called a nation to prayer, which is a great thing to do. And we're going to pray in a minute about that. But pandemic and grief is so hard, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. And it's complex, isn't it? It's a complex grief, because obviously losing someone close to you is traumatic and sad. But within in this place that we're on now, it's, you know, not being able to visit people and not being able to have a full funeral. I think it's complex, and there's so much of it as well, and the ripples, the amount of people affected, the family, the friends. We will know people that are you know, suffering that grief as well. So it's certainly important to spend that time praying.
And it's tough days, and my observation of people in Glenwood and talking to leaders, church leaders around the country, is people are weary. This is very different, this third pandemic, this third wave. And it is more difficult. And we need to be there. Church is being there for one another. Yeah. And you know, we're flawed and we get these things wrong. But maybe you could send a text to somebody or write a card or send an email or maybe phone somebody up just to encourage them. And it's the small things.
Yes.
It is those small things.
It is. I know it's those things actually that have really encouraged me. Just having, you know, the sort of a little gift on the doorstep or a card through the door. And this week I was so encouraged by Frank and Helen and Jill and Stephen's life group.
Small group.
Yeah. Sorry. I zoomed in with them and they prayed for me and for the rest of the leaders. And I just found that so encouraging, actually. So I was really grateful for that. So don't underestimate, I think.
Absolutely.
The small things. Yeah.
It's helpful as well. Somebody left us a bottle of wine on the doorstep. It was really nice, actually.
Oh, really?
Yeah, but we didn't know who it was from because there was no card.
Oh.
So thanks, Rachel.
Me.
And I had a phone call off somebody who phoned me up from the church, said, listen, Paul, I'm not phoning up to ask anything or make a bit of comment about anything. I just phoning up to see how you're doing. And that really encouraged me. So that's good. So, Rachel, how are we going to do this now?
Yes. Yeah, so we're obviously going to go into our prayer that you'll be invited to sort of join in with. But before that, we thought it'd be good if we do light a candle together. In the video, there's a sort of quite symbolic act of lighting these candles. So if we do that together as a mark of remembrance and prayer to God. God as well. So if you've got your candle, we'll do that now.
And while Rachel's doing that, let me just explain. We've put together about a 3-minute video, and we've used things from the BBC, who did something on it in the week, showing these candles being lit in a church building. And they also show a couple of people who've died through the pandemic, which is horrible, really. Mm. And then after that, there's another video which will bring us out of this into a place to help us come back to the song that we'll be singing. And then after that, there will be Paul Clarke, who is going to continue our theme of from Colossians of work in progress. And I look forward to hearing what he's got to say.
Mm. Try it. Everything is gone.
Today we're using candles to represent those who died. One light for every life lost.
God of all comfort and counsel, we pray for those who are grieving, reeling from the sudden loss of loved ones. May they find your fellowship in their suffering, your comfort in their loss, and your hope in their despair. We name before you those known to us who are vulnerable and scared, the frail, the sick, and the elderly. God of all comfort, you are powerful and merciful. May this be our prayer. He has delivered us from such a deadly peril, and he will deliver us again. On him we have set our hope that he will continue to deliver us.
Jehovah Shalom, Lord of Peace, we remember those living in coronavirus hotspots and those currently in isolation. May they know your presence in their isolation, your peace in their turmoil, and your patience in their waiting. Prince of Peace, you are powerful and merciful. Let this be their prayer. May your mercy come quickly to meet us, for we are in a desperate need. Help us, God our Saviour, for the glory of your name.
Jehovah Rapha, God who heals, we pray for all medical professionals dealing daily with the intense pressures of this crisis. Grant them resilience in weariness, discernment in diagnosis, and compassion upon compassion as they care. We thank you for the army of researchers working steadily and quietly towards a cure. Give them clarity, serendipity, and unexpected breakthrough today. Would you rise above this present darkness as the sun of righteousness with healing in your rays? May this be our prayer. Sovereign Lord, you have made the heavens and the earth by your great power and outstretched arm. Nothing is too hard for you.
May El Shaddai, the Lord God Almighty, who loves you, protect you. May Jesus Christ, his Son, who died for us, save you. May the Holy Spirit, who broods over the chaos and fills you with his presence, intercede for you and in you for others at this time. The Lord will rescue me from every evil attack and will bring me safely to his heavenly kingdom. To him be the glory forever and ever. Amen.
In our pain, our blue, our beautiful, our hard, our messy, our ugly, our struggles and our joys, God is with us. God accompanying us, God alongside us, God amid us, God among us, God beside us, God by us, God including us, God near us, God plus us, God upon us, God as companion to us, beside us, God in the thick of us, in the thick of our humanity, in the middle of this weary world, God is with us. In the gift and in the muck and mire of real life, we are called to be present, to be in the flesh with one another, accompanying others, alongside others, amid others, beside others, by others, for others, including others, near others, a companion to others, side by side with others, in the thick of others. God with us. Us with others. God with the world in the thick of the beautiful and the messy. In that, a weary world rejoices.
Of my enemies, I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. I raise a hallelujah with everything inside of me. I raise a hallelujah. I will watch the darkness flee. I raise a hallelujah in the middle of the mystery. I raise a hallelujah. The fear you lost your hold on me. Gonna sing in the middle of a storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. And I'm gonna sing in the middle of a storm. Hallelujah. I raise a hallelujah.
Good morning, everyone. This morning we're continuing our journey through Paul's letter to the church in Philippi, and we've reached one of the most well-known passages in the entire letter. Paul's finished his introduction to what might be his favourite church, if he's allowed to have a favourite. He's talked about his confinement in prison and his hopes for the future. And then he's turned to teaching the followers of Jesus in Philippi about what it looks like to live as citizens of heaven in this life. And then it's like Paul sits down in his psychologist's chair and begins to talk about the mind of Jesus. This morning's passage asks all who read it two questions. Firstly, who is Jesus? And secondly, what is our response to who Jesus is? C.S. Lewis once famously wrote in his book, A Mere Christianity, "A man who was merely a man and said the sort of things that Jesus said would not be a great moral teacher. He would either be a lunatic, on the level of the man who says he is a poached egg, or else he would be the devil of hell. You must make your choice. Either this man was and is the Son of God, or else a madman, or something worse." And whichever of these schools of thought we fall into about who we believe Jesus is, it's going to provoke, it's going to warrant some type of response from us. Philippi was an important Roman colony. It was strategically located on the modern day border between Greece and Turkey, and it's on the road where Europe meets Asia, where East meets West. And the area was rich in natural resources, gold, silver, an abundance of natural springs and wells. And it was in Philippi that the future of the Roman Empire itself was decided. In 44 BC, Mark Antony led an army from Rome that defeated the army of Brutus and Cassius, the two men responsible for the assassination of Julius Caesar. Rome would send retired veteran soldiers to settle in Philippi with their families as a reward for many years of loyal service. Philippi was a pretty big deal in the Roman Empire, and everywhere you'd looked, you'd be reminded of the power, the might, the sophistication of the Roman Empire. And it was against this type of backdrop that Paul paints a picture of a leader like no other leader the world has ever seen. And Paul begins our passage with this radical instruction. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. In other words, this leader I'm going to tell you about, you should be like him. William Barclay called this passage we're about to look at the greatest and most moving passage Paul ever wrote about Jesus. And that's quite a compliment considering how much of the New Testament Paul wrote about Jesus. That's a huge flag that we should pay close attention to what Paul wrote. So, who is Jesus? Our first clue comes from this verse. Jesus, who being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. This English phrase, being in the very nature God, doesn't do justice to the strength of this idea that Paul's seeking to convey. The original Greek language uses this word morphe, and it talks about this sense of the inner part of a person that never changes. And in the case of Jesus, that inner part was his divinity. Parts of us are constantly changing: our looks, our emotions, our age, our waistlines. But there's a part of us that makes you you and me me that will never change. And in Jesus, that part makes Jesus God, the Son of God. And Paul goes on to say that Jesus didn't want to use this divine nature for himself. In our modern day 21st century culture, I think we've lost how incredible this idea is. In the culture of Philippi, which worshipped the many pagan Greek and Roman gods who believers demanded gifts and tributes in return for godly blessings, here we have a God who lives not to please himself, but lives for others. And if that's not enough to blow people's mind, Paul adds, rather he, Jesus, made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. Some Bible translations talk about Jesus emptying himself of that divine glory that should rightfully be his, and take on the form of a human being. That same Greek word morphe appears here again to describe Jesus's humanity. Jesus is unchangeably God and unchangeably human in one person, the personhood of a servant, not a king, not a nobleman, not a dignitary, a servant. It was a hot, sweltering day in the income tax office in Amman, Jordan. An unassuming man entered the office accompanied by a family member, and he joined the back of the queue. He was dressed in shabby white robes, wore a long beard and the traditional headdress, and he began to make small talk with the people patiently waiting in line. And eventually it was his family member's turn to be seen at the counter. The family member filed some papers and they turned and left the office. And it was only when the people in that income tax office heard the engines and the sirens of the motorcade as it sped away that they'd realised something was up. That shabbily dressed man was the King of Jordan in disguise. Even though it was his face that adorned all those banknotes being passed back and forth in that income tax office, no one recognised him. The King of Jordan periodically did this to check up on how the state was serving the people. The King of Jordan may have looked different, but he was still the king. The change was purely cosmetic. Jesus didn't just look like a servant, he became the servant. All those divine privileges that our finite minds couldn't begin to understand were given up. They were emptied out so that Jesus could perform the ultimate act of servanthood the world has ever seen. And being found in appearance of a man, he, Jesus, humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. And there we have the reason why the Son of God descended from the heights of heaven to the lows of servanthood, to die that most cruel of deaths on a timber cross. Not because he had to, not because he deserved to, but because he chose to, as an act of love for you and me, to pay that ultimate price for us, to, in our place, to make right our relationship with God the Father. And he asks nothing of us in return, except our faith. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. That glory Jesus gave up when he became a man was returned to him by God, because Jesus accomplished God's redemptive plan as he died on the cross and uttered those famous words, "It is finished." And we have this forward-looking glimpse to a time that God has promised will happen, but hasn't happened yet. A time when Jesus will return once more. This time, not as a servant, but as a conquering king, to complete forevermore that famous promise from the end of our Bibles. Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. So what should our response be to who Jesus is? If you believe that Jesus is who Paul says he is, the answer to that question is both simple and very, very difficult all at the same time. Scientists have discovered that imitation is built into our genetic makeup. We have these things called mirror neurons in our brains that help us to copy others. It's the habits of those around us that can have the biggest influence on our behavior. Exposing ourselves to the right influences can have a huge impact on our lives. And for the Apostle Paul, that means more exposure to Jesus. If you believe that Jesus is who Paul says he is, it means having the same mindset as Jesus. The more we get to know the person of Jesus through prayer, through our Bibles, through the Holy Spirit of God, the more we become like Jesus. And to follow the example of Jesus means not thinking too highly of ourselves, thinking of others before we think of ourselves, and seeking to glorify God before we seek to glorify ourselves. Amen.
Thanks, Paul. As ever, you're so good. And thank you for sharing from that wonderful passage in Philippians. And he's got such a lovely face, hasn't he?
Yeah.
He's got just one of those faces that, you know, is lovely.
Oh, sorry, Paul. I never quite know what he's going to say next. Anyway, just a reminder that we have our online Zoom prayer meeting this Tuesday at 7:30. Always encouraging and great to see people's faces. So please do join if you can.
Yeah, and I'll send out the link via email and Facebook on Monday. And as Rachel says, it is a fun time. And could you just continue praying, please, for Lang Trust and for that remaining money that we really want to see come in? That would be great. So I think that's it. For now, for this week.
Yep.
So we'll just
see
say
you next week.
Bye bye.
Bye.
May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ
and the love of God
and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit
be with us all, now and evermore.
Amen.
Everyone who thinks of
still.